Okay. Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? Great. So I'm here to talk about WebGL. So if you also see me hanging out later, you should ask me about peer-to-peer decentralized social networking, peer-to-peer GitHub, whatever. This is my public key, if you want to just jot that down really fast. So I've been starting a worker cooperative for software for many of the same reasons why I'm really interested in peer-to-peer technology, like leveling power asymmetries, that kind of stuff. This presentation is about WebGL, so of course it does contain blinky lights and things like that, so if that's an issue, just be advised. So let's write some WebGL. So first of all, I'm going to be using a library called regl, or it's called regl, or it's called regl, or regl, or whatever you want. So you load the library like this. The first thing that you do once you've initialized this library is you make a draw function. So you give this draw function some options, which we're going to fill in just a moment, and then you can call it. It's a function. So with shaders, there's a few things that we'll need to do. So first thing we'll need to do, actually, before we get into our draw function, is we need to have some data to draw. So I'm going to be using a module called Icosphere for that. So Icosphere implements this format called simplicial complex, spelled like this. It's not the best name, but that's what it is. So I can show you what kind of data that looks like. So if I require Icosphere, I get a function, and I can call it with a resolution. So here's the data that we get. There's two keys. One of them is called positions, and the other one is called cells. Positions are XYZ coordinates, so it's a list of XYZ. And cells is a list of indexes into the positions array. And this describes a triangle. It could also describe an edge or a point, but in this case, we have a list of triangles. So 0 here, that's the first position. 2 is like index 2, et cetera. So with this format, we can have a mesh. So a mesh is a collection of points, and they describe triangles. And basically, that's the basic primitive that you mostly deal with in WebGL. You might also deal with points and lines, but meshes of triangles are extremely common. So we'll load up an Icosphere with resolution 3. I could print it out with console log, but in this case, I want to create a draw function for that mesh. So the first thing that we need to do, I'm going to define a fragment shader. And this is these backticks are template string literals. I don't know if you've seen those before. These are like the best part of ES6 for this kind of work. I pretty much don't use anything else. But these are great. So we need to define two shaders. And shaders are written in this language called GLSL. It's very similar to C, but it's simpler. It has some basic types like matrices and vectors built in. You can sort of do integers, but mostly you deal with floating point values. So I'm just going to write out some basic boilerplate. You have to define the precision of floating points. If you want to make something that works on bad devices like my computer or a cell phone, you do medium p float. Otherwise, you could do high p. I think high p works on this one. So then you define a main function. And I'll just do that for both of them, and then we'll come back to this in a moment. So here we have our main function for both our fragment and our vertex shader. So the next thing that we need to do before we actually write our implementations of these is to plumb the data from our mesh into WebGL. So we can do that by using this thing called an attribute. So with an attribute, these are variables that are defined for every vertex in the mesh. For every vertex in the mesh, what happens is the vertex shader takes those geometries and maps them to screen coordinates. So it takes them, puts them onto the screen, like an XY coordinate. So we're going to have one called position. And remember that the mesh, the simplicial complex that I showed a moment ago, was comprised of positions and cells. So we're going to use positions here as an attribute. The other thing that we need to do is to load in the triangles, the cells. So we can do that by passing in elements, so mesh.cells. OK, so we can call this draw function right away. That'll draw a single thing to the screen. Now, in the vertex shader, so there's a few different things about GLSL that I'll need to kind of cover here. So when you have an attribute that you've defined, you know, you can call these whatever you want. So here, the key is called position. So what we can do is we know that it's a vec3 because the simplicial complex format is xyz coordinates. So we do attribute vec3 position. And then inside of our main function now, we can use that. So in a vertex shader, you write to this global variable called gl underscore position. And that's a vec4. So vec4 is just a, it's like an array that is size 4, and it doesn't change size ever. So what we're going to need to do is map that position into screen coordinates. So in this case, you wouldn't normally do this, but for the purposes of demonstration, I'm going to take the vec3 and kind of like just stuff a 1 at the end. And that'll be enough to fit in there and draw something on the screen. So the final thing that we need to do is the job of the fragment shader is to set this global variable called glfragColor with that exact casing. So when we do this, we set a vec4 that is the R, G, B, and A channel. So in this case, I'll just use some pre-baked values, like 0.5, 0.51. So this will be sort of like a teal, greenish-blue color. So I think that that's all we need to do. So the next thing that we'll need to do, I realized I should have, well, it's OK, is I'm going to run this command called budo, which runs Browserify as a dev server. So I made a file called main.js, and I'm going to run budo on that. And it runs a web server that I can connect to now on this port 9966. So if I go there in a browser to localhost 9966, I see a circle, which is great. That's like a sphere. It's squished weird. And I'll get into that, why that is. Well, we'll make it better. But we see something at all on the screen. This is one of the hardest things about WebGL, is if you're, you might not get any errors. You might not have any kind of problem like that. But you might just see nothing. So it's very good that we've gotten to this point. OK. So the next thing that we can do is we can use a perspective. So to do this, normally you can use this module called glmat4. So you can require glmat4. And this is a 4x4 matrix. So if you've ever taken linear algebra, that would cover this kind of concept. But for now, all that you need to know is that matrices are used to express translations, rotations, and like how big something is, and can also express the sort of perspective effect that you get with a camera. Or maybe it could express the kind of top-down effect you might see in an isometric game. So we could set up a perspective matrix. You could call mat4.perspective with a bunch of options, the FOV, whatever, whatever, whatever. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to use a module, because we're at a Node conference. That's what we're all about. OK. So I'm going to use this module called regl camera. And that expects the regl instance, which is what we're using to draw WebGL. And you can pass in things like a distance or like the eye position. I'll leave most of these to be the defaults, but I'll set a distance of 3. So the camera is going to be unit 3 from the origin, which is 0, 0, 0. OK, so now to use this camera, you call camera here. You give it a function, and then you can put whatever you're going to draw inside of there. So what camera does is it sets up these things called uniform variables. You can set up uniforms yourself, and we'll be doing that a bit later, by passing in uniforms like this, just like we defined attributes. And it works similarly to attributes, except uniforms are available everywhere in the program, in the fragment shader and the vertex shader. They're not like attributes, which are only per vertex. So in our vertex shader, remember, the vertex shader's job is to map object geometry coordinates to screen coordinates. So we need to define these variables. So we can do uniform mat4 projection, comma view. So this is going to let the camera module take care of setting up a perspective matrix and a view matrix for us. You don't really have to know too much about how that works to kind of get the basic idea here. So we can use matrix multiplication to multiply our projection and view matrices by the position. So in GLSL, you use the star operator, just like you use in JavaScript, and you multiply these things together. So here we have our projection matrix times our view matrix times a VEC4 with the position. And now instead of just splatting that spherical geometry onto the screen, ignoring the z-coordinate, we'll actually set up a proper projection. So if I reload this, we should, yeah, so now we see a better sphere. The other cool thing about the regl camera module in particular is that, so here, we don't actually have any kind of animation loop, but I can easily set one up using this command called regl.frame. So this calls calls request animation frame in the browser to run at about 60 FPS if your computer is good enough for that. So here I can just wrap the whole thing in regl.frame, and now this will be called every 16 or 17 milliseconds. And the cool thing about the camera module is that you get zoom. So here I can zoom in and out with my trackpad, or I can rotate. Of course, it's a sphere, so rotating doesn't really tell you much. But we're making some progress. OK. So one of the next things that we can do is we'll use a new concept. We've covered uniforms and attribute variables. We can use a new concept called a varying variable. So with the vertex shader, you might want to define variables that you later use in the fragment shader. And how varying variables work is, remember that the vertex shader defines coordinates. The vertex shader runs for every vertex in your mesh, so every point. What you can do is set up a varying, like I'll do a varying VEC3 with something called VPause and VNorm. You can't use the same names because that would be a clash of variables. So what I can do is set vpause to be position and also vnorm to be position. Vnorm is this thing called a surface normal. It just so happens that we're dealing with a sphere with radius 1, which is the unit sphere. And in that case, we don't the surface normal is going to be the same as the position. We'll change that later, but for now, this is going to be how it goes. So you declare a varying with the varying keyword, and then you assign to it. And then, in your fragment shader, you also do a varying. So vpause, comma, vnorm. Now, inside of our VEC3, for example, instead of this teal color, we can use the surface normal to color our sphere, which looks pretty cool. This might seem very familiar. It's kind of a very common aesthetic. So you see a sphere. It's not great on this projector, but you can see that it has different colors in different sections. So the surface normal is a line that points out from the surface. It's like if you have a flat surface, then the normal is going to be pointing this way. And if I change it, it works like that. It's the best I can do. OK, so getting back to our program, we can make some fun things happen now. So we have this basic demo. Another thing to cover is we can set the background color by calling clear, which maps to an OpenGL call behind the scenes. So we can set a color. Maybe we'll set it to black. You have to set the alpha channel to 1, always. Just remember that. And I'll also clear the depth buffer. You don't have to know what that means. I don't even know what that means. But here we go. Now we have a black background. That's cool. We can use any color we want to do that. So it would be really fun if we could have something besides just a sphere. So one way that we can do that is to create noise on the sphere. So you might be familiar with noise in JavaScript. You might call math.random to get one number back between 0 and 1. But there are different kinds of noise. There's this thing called Perlin noise or simplex noise, And the cool thing about that sort of noise is that it takes parameters. Like, it might take a float, or it might take a vec2, or a vec3, or even a vec4. And given that input, it deterministically produces an output that looks really cool and blobby. So that's what we'll be doing here. To use an implementation of noise, that's not built into GLSL. So what we'll have to do is use a module. It just so happens that there's one called GLSL-noise. You can npm install GLSL noise. But to use it, we're going to be using this thing called glslify. So you can require glslify like this. And I think I'll explain what it does on the command line best here. So when you require glslify in Node, it's a function. And you can give it something like a shader source, right? So void main, you know, we've got our basic shader. But the cool thing is that, so here we just get back, you know, basically the same thing as we put in. But there's this syntax where we can do pragma glslify colon space, and then you can do require calls in your shader code, just like you would do in JavaScript. So I can do snoise equals require glsl-noise. And I get, well, I get an error because I did it wrong. But oh no. Oh, I might as well mention this really great trick. If you've ever used CacheMin Infinity before, you can install things from your local cache, which is great if you give a presentation and you forget to install a module, which I just did. OK. So once we have that, see, it's very fast. I'm not even on the internet. So anyways, getting back to this demo, if we require that, I did something else wrong. But the important part is that we can use modules. And just like a bundler would do for your front-end code, just like Browserify would do, GLSLify will do. So to set it up, we can use a Browserify transform when we run Budo. So you can either set this up in your package JSON, or you can pass it directly to Budo like this, -t glslify. So now, when we require the glslify package, we can use glsl as a tagged template string function. So this means that here our fragment shader and our vertex shader are going to be run through this pipeline that will let us use modules. So here I'm going to do pragma glslify snoise equals require glsl noise. I now remember why it didn't work. It's because you have to actually require this nested package. But so anyways, this should give us three-dimensional noise. So if we give snoise a 3D point, a vec3, we'll get back a floating point value between -1 and 1. So here's what that looks like. First of all, if we, instead of using just the position directly, use vpos, which we'll pass to our fragment shader, we can add in some noise. So I'm going to just juggle some things around. So if you think about this, there's points on the sphere, right? So if we want to put a vertex on the sphere, we want to make it blob out in a cool way, we can take the position plus the surface normal, which is pointing out, remember, like this. It points out a certain amount, and we can scale that by the amount of noise. So what that looks like is you can take the position and add the normal to S noise of whatever you want. So we're going to be using the position on the sphere as the input and scale it by a little bit. So I'll show you what that looks like. Looks like nothing. Thank you. OK. Oh, yeah, this should be position. I've done this so many times, actually. That's a very common mistake. There we go. We now have a lumpy sphere. That's pretty cool. So you can notice that it's a little bit jagged. So I'm just going to turn up the geometry. So instead of a precision of 3 for icosphere, I'm going to use 5, because that looks much smoother. And here we go. It's a smooth, cool sphere. So there's another trick we can do with uniforms now. Let's make it animate. Let's make this noise flow and look really cool. So to do that, we're going to pass in a uniform into our vertex shader called time. So regl will keep track of the simulation time in seconds. So all that we need to do is set a uniform called time So with any property in regl, you can pass in a function instead of a value, and then it will be evaluated for every tick, basically, every time we want to draw a new frame. So you get two values in any function you pass in, the context and the props. There's a context.time that we'll want to return. So this will do what we want. Or you can also write that same thing as this shortcut. So these mean the same thing right here. So I'm going to use the short one for now. And in the vertex shader now, we can use time. And maybe instead of 3D noise, we'll use 4D noise. Four dimensions. Whoa. So how that will look is now instead of S noise of position, we can do the S noise of vec4 position, comma time. So time will be our fourth dimension. Pretty trippy. Okay. And if I let that run, we get a blobby sphere. Okay, so that's cool and all. How can we take these concepts and push them even further? So one fun thing that we can do is maybe instead of just this using surface normals, what if we made cool wavy patterns in our fragment shader? So just like in our vertex shader, we can use glslify. So you just do pragma glslify, require S noise, and then instead of the V norm, we can use the S noise. And in fact, I'm going to use another package in my fragment shader called HSL to RGB, which lets us operate in HSL color space, hue, saturation, luminosity. So we can require that package, HSL to RGB, like that, which you can install with NPM. And now we can define some things like hue and saturation and luminosity. So I'm going to define some HSNL. And I'll hard code luminosity and saturation to begin with. But for hue, I'll use S noise, just like we were doing a moment ago in our vertex shader. So we're already passing in the V pause and the V norm as varying variables. So now we can use those in our fragment shader in the same way that we were using them in our vertex shader. So with 4D noise, we'll pass in vpause, comma, time. And also, we'll need the uniform variable called time in our fragment shader. So uniform float time, like so. And now the color, instead of vnorm, will become HSL to RGB, H, comma, S, comma, L. So if I've done all of that correctly, we should see. Oh, good call. Good audience participation. Thank you. Uh-oh. So this is actually a good opportunity to look at the debugging messages that regl gives you that are very hard. So this one I happen to know in particular, string not ASCII, is caused when you don't set up glslify correctly. I don't know why that would be, glsl. Sometimes if you just run it again, it works. I don't know. Or sometimes if you do pragma instead of pragma, it would cause an error such as that. See how this goes. Shader string syntax error. That is the worst error because it means something bizarre. I'm going to comment out HSL to RGB just so that we made sure that we don't have an issue. So I'll just use a placeholder thing, 0111. I like that one. It's cyan. It's good for demos. OK, so that works. I think there maybe is an issue with GLSL HSL to RGB. That's OK. We don't have to have that necessarily, although it would have been great. Yeah, vpause. Any audience members see in? It's installed. Which one? Oh, you're right. Wow, I spaced that. Thank you, audience. That is fantastic. Fantastic collaborative debugging. And there we go. Fantastic. Okay, so this is cool and all. How can we make it better? So I think a really fun thing to do is to have a simple feedback effect. So there's a cool module called regl feedback that'll make it kind of like spread out. Maybe we'll do that now. Yeah, and then we'll do the final part. OK. So let's use this feedback module. So it's called regl feedback. So you require regl feedback. You pass in, I believe, regl is the first as the argument. And then the second argument, which I can never remember, is a piece, is a GLSL function that's a vec3. You have to call it sample, I believe. And then it's a vec2 with a UV, which is a convention in GLSL for the screen coordinates. And also a sampler 2D, which is a texture. So you do this. I can never, off the top of my head, think of a cool thing to do. So we're going to use this command line module called readme to read the documentation. So it's called regl feedback. And there's a sweet thing in the documentation here that we're just going to copy-paste. Yeah, this thing right here. I'm just going to copy the whole thing, because I might have messed that up as well. It's just that part. And then there's a bit of setup. It's a little bit difficult, but you know, you can quickly read the docs or like when you're giving a presentation. And OK, so anyways, we have this feedback function. We're also going to need a texture. So I'll just call it text. And you can call regl.texture to set one of those up. Regl.texture also works if you want to load assets. So I'm not going to do that in this presentation. But if you do want to load assets, you can use this module called resl, R-E-S-L, and just pass in those assets to regl.texture. And then you can have textures, and it looks really cool. OK, so we have a texture now, and we have our feedback function. To run it, I'm also going to look at the documentation, because it's very difficult to remember this stuff off the top of my head. Right. So you do copy true, min linear, mag linear, of course. Yeah, I know that. All right. So obviously. OK, so what we'll need to do is the first thing is, after we clear the screen, we're going to need to draw the texture. So you draw the texture by calling the feedback function called feedback with the texture, like this. And then we're going to, at the end of all of our drawing, which is going to be right here in our program, we need to copy out the contents of the screen to a texture. So you do that by calling text, copy true, min linear, mag linear, something like that. And then there's one last thing, I think. Maybe that'll work. We'll see. Yeah, it works. So cool. Now we have a feedback effect. And anything we do on the screen is copied out, and it expands. So that's a pretty fun effect. But wait, let's do some more stuff. What else can we do? One thing that I think is fun is if we want to make our simulation react to user input. So let's have it so that when I press the space bar, the simulation goes just like jerks out and makes a cool, I don't know, something. It'll be great. OK, so to do this, we can, we're in JavaScript, right? We're in the DOM right here, window.addEventListener. Listener for key down. And then the space bar happens to be hex code 0x20 or 32. Just know that off the top of my head. It's fine. So when we hit the space bar, what we can do is set a variable. I'm going to have two variables, one called time and one called ripple. And I'm going to set ripple to be time plus 1 whenever you hit the space bar. So time is going to be based on regl.frame. You actually get context. So I'm a little bit cheating, because I already figured out how to do this in advance. But that's why you're watching my presentation. Anyways, so we're going to set time to be the context.time inside of our frame loop. And remember, that runs about every 16 milliseconds or so at 60 FPS. So the final thing that we need to do is pass in the ripple as a property. So whenever you have a draw function with regl, you can pass in properties. This is really useful. So we'll have a property called ripple. And now, inside of our uniforms for our draw function, we'll have a second thing. Whoops. We'll have a second thing called ripple. And you know, we could define it like this, and then return props.ripple. Or there's shorthand for that. And it looks like this, regl.prop. Props or prop? I think it's prop. We'll find out. OK. Maybe it's props. I think it's prop. Anyways, so now inside of our code, we should have access to a floating point uniform called REPL. So what we can do, it's very simple, is multiply by one, wait, let's see. Multiply, instead of multiplying by 0.2, multiply by 0.2 plus REPL. And the other thing that we need to do is actually define REPL so that it doesn't go negative on us. So I'm actually going to use that function. And we will not know whether it's prop or props. OK. So return math.max of 0, comma props.REPL. OK. So if everything goes right, it probably won't. Oh, it does. Great. So it's tuned up pretty high. It doesn't go down again, but we hit the space bar and it reacts. That's cool. I think I did something a bit off here. Oh, right, it should be context.time minus props.ripple. That's going to look cooler. Hang on a sec, I got this. Well, it's hard to tell what's going on now. Oh, there we go. Oh, yeah, the first time it gets a little bit messed up, but maybe it's actually props.ripple minus, that's what it is. So this is a great introduction to how computer graphics work. You fiddle with it somewhat randomly until it looks cool. There we go. That works like I wanted it to work. So you hit the space bar. It does a cool thing. So that's WebGL. Hopefully this was a good introduction. There are no further slides. So thanks.